Ethelbert Miller. Welcome to The Scholars, a television interview series that explores contemporary scholarship. We hope to engage and challenge your thinking on a broad range of topics. You will meet a diverse group of scholars who are investigating and thinking about our complex and changing world. Ralph Eubanks is currently the Director of Publishing at the Library of Congress in Washington, D.C., where he has served since 1995. At the Library of Congress, Ralph has managed the publication of more than 80 nonfiction books on American history, photography, maps, and film in collaboration with leading trade publishers. Recently, the University of Virginia announced his appointment as editor of the Virginia Quarterly Review. As the editorial leader, he will provide creative direction to the organization and shape the content for the print and digital magazine, website, and ebooks. Welcome, Ralph.
Thank you. It's good to be here with you.
You know, when I think about you, I think of the Library of Congress first, and then I think of Mississippi. And coming from Mississippi and being a writer, how is your life different from Richard Wright and Eudora Welty? What have you been a witness to?
Wow, that's a really great question, because those are two writers I admire greatly. I'd say that I've been witness to, you know, a really big change in Mississippi, a place that I left thinking I would never go back to, that I'm there as often as I can get there now, because there is something there that keeps drawing me back. And I think that, unlike Wright, who really had to leave and couldn't come back, I feel very fortunate that I have been able to go back. And I think, like Welty, I see the value in going back. And that's something that I really learned from rereading her work, which I continue to turn to today.
Now, you grew up in a small town in Mississippi.
800 people.
Right. Okay. And when you look at that experience, in terms of here you are in Washington, D.C., what is the change in terms of your life, in terms of going from a small town to a larger city?
I think probably the biggest thing is the anonymity. And that's one of the things I do like about being in a large city, is, you know, you're walking around and it's not everybody knows who you are. Right. Whereas in a small town, everyone knows who you are. I was in Mount Olive just 2 weeks ago, and I walk into Powell's drugstore on Main Street, and it's as if I never left. Yeah. And everyone knows who you are. Or if they don't, they make a phone call to find out who is that person. And within minutes, they know.
Now, as a writer, did you want to keep some of these stories that you were witness to alive? Did you want to write some of these stories down?
I really did want to keep them alive, because when I finally went back to Mount Olive after being away for so many years, my people who were like my grandparents, I lived with them my senior year of high school. I remember Pawpaw, that's what I called him, said to me, "Ralph, Mount Olive is dying." And it was at that moment that I knew that somehow I had to tell the story of this place that really did shape me.
Now, you're a graduate of the University of Mississippi. How did the history of that institution influence you in terms of especially race? You know, did you walk across that campus and see the ghosts of segregation?
Well, what I always remember, and I have to quote my mother here, because she would say, "I can't go on that campus without seeing blood on the Lyceum steps." And I heard that so much. I didn't see the blood, but I did see the bullet holes, which were real touchstones for me when I was there. These are bullet holes that were put there when the riot broke out in September of 1962, when Meredith was admitted. Right. And I walked through those doors where he was admitted on a daily basis on my shortcut to the library. And you couldn't walk through that building without thinking about that time, without reflecting on it in some way. So, you know, there were ghosts there, but they were very much alive.
Did people talk about it? I mean, in terms of, you know, you're there much years later. And I'm just wondering, in terms of talking to other black students, was this something that the faculty kept alive in terms of discussion? Was this history used as a way of bringing the race together?
It was not talked about at all. It was referred to as the incident.
The incident.
And it was not to be spoken about. I remember people going to see the bullet holes, and we were told to be kind of quiet about it when we went to see them. So it wasn't something that was sought to bring people together. That's what the university has done now. And that's what, I think that's why today I'm so proud to be a graduate of the University of Mississippi, mm-hmm. because the university finally acknowledged we can't continue to sweep this under the rug. It does no one any good. If we really embrace this past of ours, mm-hmm. we're going to be much better off in the long run, and we're going to be able to move forward. And that's what they've done, and I'm very proud that they've moved on in that way.
I'm going to ask you some questions about that, but I want to bring in something else that's part of your background, which I've heard you touch on but not really elaborate on, and that is that you're Catholic. and you're Catholic in the South. Take me into your house in terms of how does that faith affect you in terms of, you know, being raised Catholic and being in the South?
Well, I wasn't raised Catholic.
Oh, okay.
See, I was raised a Methodist. I was raised in the CME Church.
Oh, so you're Catholic now.
I became a Catholic at the age of 18. So after my 18th birthday.
Now, talk about that. I mean, did you go back home and tell somebody, well, this is still kept hush-hush in Mississippi?
It was not accepted very much, but it was coming to be accepted. I think I tell people that I really became a Catholic in an intellectual sense at the age of 18.
What were you reading? What happened to you?
Probably reading Thomas Merton.
Thomas Merton, right.
You know, the seven-story mountain.
Right.
And so I became this Catholic in an intellectual way rather than, as my friend Paul Hendrickson calls him, washed in the blood Catholic. Mm-hmm. But I think in time you really do become washed in the blood.
But this is interesting because I want to get into your books, because here we see in terms of a decision that you make intellectually in terms of, okay, I'm reading this work and now it connects with me some way. Okay, how does that shape your understanding of who you are in Mississippi?
I think it has a big impact on who I am, and I really wanted to find my own way intellectually, and I think becoming a Catholic was part of that. Mm-hmm. When you're brought up in, you know, the CME Church, which was, you know, for years the Colored Methodist Church and the Christian Methodist Episcopal Church, but as we all know, it's really the Country Methodist.
Right.
We were the Country Methodist, and I came to this realization that I wanted this real presence, mm-hmm. That was in the Eucharist. That became very, very clear to me that I needed that real presence, whereas it wasn't thought to be real in the Methodist Church. And that's what I feel on Sundays, and it's a very important part of my life.
And you also, as you begin to your studies at the University of Mississippi, you're moving into psychology.
I'm moving into psychology, I'm moving into philosophy. I mean, I actually started out as a pre-med student because that's what my father wanted me to do. I had the psychology major to kind of satisfy him, but I was still, I mean, I ended up with enough hours to have a degree in English, but an undeclared degree. It's right. Considered a minor, which is why I went on to study English literature as a graduate student. But yes, psychology is a big influence on me. Someone asked me recently, how has studying psychology affect your life professionally? I said, well, really, it's been, I guess, in two ways, in how I've approached people and managed people as a manager, so much of what I learned then, and how I read literature.
Yeah, see, I'm looking at it more not in terms of you managing people, but how this now moves into in terms of your actual writing and examining writing your memoir. So I want to ask you to talk about the house at the end of the road, talk a little bit more about your family background. When did you begin to start researching your family history?
I started researching my family history when I was working on my first book, Ever is a Long Time, because that I wrote a paragraph about my grandparents in that book because I felt the reader needed to know that one piece about me. My grandfather was my maternal grandfather was a white man, Jim Richardson. married to a black woman, married around 1915 in Alabama, South Alabama. And it wasn't something that was talked about when I was growing up. And when you write a memoir, it has to be as honest as possible. You have to put everything out there on the page. And I wanted to put that out there. And my editor at the time wanted to know more and was afraid I was holding back.
Well, let me ask you this, because I've written memoirs, so we've talked about this. There are family secrets, okay?
Right.
This is a small town in Mississippi, okay? Your grandfather's picture's in the closet, okay? It seems as if you are walking across some very fragile bridges here, you know, in terms of you're the writer now in this family. There must be some things that are not in the book.
There are some things that are not in the book to be respectful of my family, yes. But I've been honest. I think you can be honest without being hurtful.
I'm going to bring a little sports here. You can be honest, but don't you have to touch first base to get to second?
Absolutely. You do have to. But I think one of the things that a writer told me once, he said, writing a memoir is not about settling scores.
Right.
It's really about telling the truth on the page. And I really wanted to tell the truth. Did I want to tell everything? I think sometimes there can be a little bit too much on the page, much revealed.
But now we're hearing truth as it regards now as you pull into the South, race, sex, all these issues, for some people might be taboo.
I mean, they're absolutely taboo.
Right. Now, how do you balance that?
I think it's in the voice. It's in the voice. The way that you actually talk about them, the way you lead the reader into it, and you tell the reader enough to allow them to make their own conclusions without revealing too much. I know people who've read my books have, you know, either I've met them at readings or some of them even called me on the phone occasionally and will say, you know, after reading your book, I feel as if I know you. Mm-hmm. And I take that as a real compliment. But at the same time, I also know there's so much that they don't know mm-hmm. because there's only so much that you as a writer want to reveal on the page because there's so much that you have to keep for yourself.
You know, I asked you earlier about the South and what you were witness to, okay? When we read about your life, we do encounter the whole concept of passing, okay? I wonder, how do we now deal with that concept in a world where we hear terms like multicultural? Okay, whereas people seem to be, you know, doing DNA research, knowing that they're black. How does that now present itself in terms of a new type of story being discussed?
I think it is a new story. The scholar Charles Johnson wrote about this, the new African-American narrative. And it is a new narrative. It's a new way of thinking about the world and not just in black and white. I mean, I have to say, as much as I've written about this topic and as much as I try not to look at someone and think that I know their story just from the way they look,
right.
I was a little taken aback by someone describing me in an article as being multiracial because that's not the identity I grew up with. Now, that's the identity my children have mm-hmm. grown up with, but at the same time, whether they are multiracial or whether they are black mm-hmm. depends on the situation. And for them, it's not passing. It's this fluid sense of race because they feel that all of these things are part of who they are rather than having to choose one or the other. My kids say they would never say that they were white, but they would never not say they were black.
Let me ask you this personal question. Do you write with a concern in terms of, okay, I have this audience, but I'm also writing for my children? I have, you know, you have three children. Maybe they'll pick up your book. I find many times people in the household, the kids don't read your books, but that's another issue. But, you know, are you saying, okay, I want to put this on the page. I went through this in my life. I did the research. I found out about my grandparents. I want to make sure that if my children pick this book up, it'll help them explain the world, or the world will explain to them.
I think that's a part of it. I'd say that I wrote my books in a lot of ways for them, and I was trying to see the world through their eyes and realizing the way they're looking at the world is very different from the way I looked at the world, and trying not to impose a vision of the world on them, which is what I know happened to me. And at the time that I was growing up, that was done for the sake of my survival. And I feel very fortunate that I don't have to do that with my children for them to survive. There are other things in the world that they're going to have to navigate and learn on their own that I'm not going to be privy to, that I hope one day they'll write about as well.
Now, in your book, Ever is a Long Time, A Journey into Mississippi's Dark Past, what did you uncover?
I think probably the main thing that I uncovered, I think there are really two things I uncovered, really, about how the Sovereignty Commission, which was Mississippi's spy agency during the Civil Rights Movement, was omnipresent.
And your parents were surveilled.
Yes, my parents were under surveillance, along with lots of other people in Mississippi at the time. So learning how that all worked was one big part of it. And I think probably the part of it that's more important to me, and that continues to be important to me, is realizing that I actually did love this place, this crazy place that I came from. I think I even said in the book that Mississippi is like the crazy relative that you love, because there's still something there to love. And there's still something there for me to love, something that keeps drawing me back. But I think what I learning what Mississippi was like and wanting to continue to learn what Mississippi was like is probably the more important thing that I uncovered in the course of writing that book. And it's the thing I'm still uncovering.
Well, talking about love, I know that when I come to see you at the Library of Congress, you seem to be one person who enjoy your job, okay?
I do.
and you're going to be leaving, and we'll talk a little bit about that. But how did you arrive at the Library of Congress? I mean, if someone was going to replace you, what would you recommend they do and to prepare them for the job at the Library of Congress in terms of being in charge of publishing? And what does that job entail?
Well, the job, it's a really big job. Thinking about it, there are 150 million items in the collections of the Library of Congress. That doesn't even include the books. So I would say someone coming in, it's to learn the collections. I remember my first week at the library, how exhausted I was, because I was working on this book, Eyes of the Nation, A Visual History of the United States. And I was in every curatorial division of the library looking at items related to American history. It was kind of a complete immersion.
No lunch break.
No. Complete immersion into primary sources about American history.
Are you doing this by yourself, or are you doing this with a team of people?
I'm doing this with a team of people, and they're all guiding me through it. Mm-hmm. And I remember at the end of the week, I told my wife, I said, this is the most intellectually challenging job I have ever had in my life, and I really love this. Mm-hmm. Because I went in every day and I learned something new. And I have to say that that's been the great thing. It's why I've been there for 18 years, is that every day I walk in, I'm in a collection, I learn something new. Or someone brings out an object that, yes, we know it's there. It's been cataloged, but no one's really looked at it in a while. There hasn't been an occasion to look at it. And then you look at it with 21st century eyes, and you see something really new there. It's like the first time I saw the photographs that W.E.B. Du Bois commissioned for the Paris Exposition in 1900. And remember seeing this photograph of these young men in Atlanta, knowing that they're just one generation removed from slavery. And it just notes that, young men in Atlanta, Georgia. I wanted to know their names.
Right.
I wanted to know who took the photograph. And I want to know their story. And that's what really motivated the book we did, A Small Nation of People, is that bringing in David Levering Lewis and Deborah Willis mm-hmm. to help tell that story. Something that I saw in a photograph, but I knew I couldn't tell the story, but I wanted to bring together the people.
Well, see,
I'm looking
at you now as Duke Ellington, you know? Because you know what happens is that, and this is where, you know, to me, race makes a difference, because what happens, listening to you talk about your past, okay, understanding Mississippi history and your ability now to go back to Mississippi, and, you know, even in 2013, it means that now when you're looking at these pictures, you bring something to this, okay? You want to tell the complete story, okay? And you're in the position to do it. What about the other part of the job in terms of just, okay, here's the collection, how do I negotiate the deal? How do I get somebody else excited about this so we see it?
I find that a really exciting part of my job is getting someone actually interested in it. So pulling all the things together there, and so often, and this is one of the wonderful things about working with curators, they bring out the things that they really love. And one of the things they've learned about working with me, I said, I know you really love this, but what story does this tell? I need to tell a story. And this looks like there's a story. And then they tell me, I said, that's the story. This may be the more significant object to you as a curator. This has the more interesting story, because that's what I can get the publisher interested in. It's all about the story.
You know, when you say that, I feel like I'm talking to Ken Burns, because, you know, it sounds like, okay, if I'm going to make this film, say, on baseball or Civil War, I'm looking at, okay, what's the story angle? Okay, what is this really about? So all of a sudden you look up, baseball might be about race, okay? Mm-hmm. Are there any books that you mentioned one, that you're very happy about at the end of your tenure in terms of, well, I'm glad my fingerprints touched this book?
I think, you know, Eyes of the Nation is a book that I'm exceptionally proud of. Cartographia Mapping Civilizations is another book. Our visual timeline of the Civil War, but I think there are 9 little books we did on FSA photographers that I, you know, it's 50 photographs, an introduction by a writer, you know, getting Kurt Anderson to write about John Vachon, who photographed his native Omaha, Nebraska. And, you know, that's a real treat, getting Francine Prose to write about Marion Post Wolcott. So getting to work with these writers and saying, you know, knowing how they've used photography and visual imagery, I guess going back to psychology again, to really amplify their work, giving them 50 images and saying, give me a beautiful essay about these, not from the standpoint of a photo historian, but from a standpoint of a writer.
You sound like you're talking as editor of the Virginia Quarterly Review. Because, you know, I mean, this is a beautiful publication, which, you know, leans heavily on photography. This must be icing now in terms of a second job in which you can say, wow, I can really shape, you know, photo essays. I can really reach maybe a whole new audience.
That's one of the things that really does excite me about the job, is thinking about working with contemporary photographers and doing features with them, or thinking about a story. Well, what is it that's visually going to draw the reader in to read this piece of short fiction? Because in the digital age, the visual has become so important, but you don't want people to, you've got to use the visual to get them to the substance.
So what happens is that you take over while I'm holding this, okay? What's going to happen in terms of, is this going to be completely online? I mean, what's going to happen
It's going to continue to be in print, because there are people who still want print. And, you know, to be honest, I think that's probably the way those photographs are going to reproduce the best. That's the way that the reader is going to be able to interact with those photographs the best. There will be a digital, I mean, right now you can download the Virginia Quarterly Review for your digital device. So there are people who read it that way. I don't care how people read it. All I care about is that they read. And what I want to do as an editor is give them things that they want to read and engage with: literature, ideas, poetry.
Let me ask you one last tough question. What is the Virginia Quarterly not doing that you would like to see it do?
I think the big thing that I like to do is organize it and have some departments, that some regular features, so that whenever you pick up an issue, there are some things that you turn to first. Whenever I pick up my issue of The New Yorker, I read the talk of the town first. Mm-hmm. Or I look at the index when I look at my Harper's. I look at the brief features in the front of The Atlantic. So I want to have some features like that that also fit in with the ethos of the magazine, which has been using photography as well as literature.
So I'm not going to find a little Mississippi column in the Virginia Quarterly?
Well, you won't find a Mississippi column, although I'm sure that there will be
a strong Mississippi presence.
There'll be a strong Mississippi presence. You know, William Faulkner said it best: all Mississippians aspire to be Virginians in some way.
Okay, so. I'll remind you who won the war. Thank you, Ralph. Thank you for being my guest, and I wish you the best.
Thank you very much.
And Ralph, thank you for joining me on The Scholars, and thank you for watching. I'm E. Ethelbert Miller. Mm-hmm.